Okay. Now we're moving right along into our, we're still in the series one, Lec 10, and this morning we're moving along in the basic doctrines of the Bible. And we're in Lec 10a, and we're moving into the doctrine of the Holy Spirit. We just completed the test for the doctrine of Jesus Christ in Lec 9, and now we're in doctrine of the Holy Spirit, which is our lecture 10. Get on the Bible. Okay. So now we're in the third person of the Trinity, third and final person of the Trinity, which is the Holy Spirit, which is a very vital part of the believer's life of today. And so we are living now in the dispensation or age of the Holy Spirit. And that is so is because of the outpouring that took place during the day of Pentecost. We are still in that dispensation of the power of the Holy Spirit. The Old Testament may be called the age of the Father. The second period covered by the Gospels is the age of the Son. And then we have, from the time of Pentecost until the second coming of Christ, is the age of the Spirit. So underline that we are living in the dispensation of the Holy Spirit. The Old Testament is the age of the Father. The second period covered by the Gospel are the age of the Son, which entails the day of Pentecost. And that goes all the way until the second coming of Christ. The age of the Spirit.
All that you just said.
Yeah, you can. Yeah, let's underline the second period. Underline the first script. The first sentence, all the way to the Holy Spirit, and then the second period. Well, it's after the Old Testament may be called the age of the Father. Start where it says the second period covered by the Gospels, which is the age of the Son, from Pentecost to the second coming of Christ. So the Apostle Paul realized that the New Testament Christians must have the power of God in their lives as manifested by and through the Holy Spirit. Many reject the concept of the Holy Spirit living and dwelling within us because he is also known as the Holy Ghost. And I believe many reject that knowledge and sort of like it's foreign to them. It's because it's not a way, when you're coming from the old to the new, there's such a vast difference as to how they saw the power of God. Because basically back then they actually saw the power of God actually manifested itself in their very physical eyesight. So the old is a prototype of the new. The old is a work of the outward efforts of man, which is represented by the law, and the new is dependent upon the work of the Holy Spirit mm-hmm. within the man, mm-hmm. you know, to work in us and then out of us. For instance, when they did a lot of warfare and fighting, and what they did was they actually literally killed their enemies. I mean, like the Old Testament say, an eye for an eye, a tooth for a tooth.
Say the old is a what of the new
is like a prototype. It's a replica of the new. It's you're doing the same thing, but you're doing it on a spiritual level. And so that's why the Holy Spirit is so vital. And this is why those that are still living under the culture and the umbrella of the law can't quite understand, and that's why many reject that concept of the Holy Spirit living and dwelling within us. And it's sort of hard for them to receive, like the virgin birth, because I mean, we done been doing it like this all this time. How you gonna come up and try to change this? Underline that where it says many reject the concept of the Holy Spirit living and dwelling within us, because he's also known as the Holy Ghost. The last paragraph, the last sentence of the first paragraph. So many reject it because of ignorance and they're not having an understanding of the power of the Trinity. That the Holy Spirit was there a long time ago. It's just that God desired to do things different. Now he will dwell, he will be within you. We're on page 106. The lesson you got this one. Lec10a. Did you get page 106? Webster gives us a brief definition of the Holy Spirit as a life-giving force, the active presence of God in human life, the third person of the Trinity. Underline the definition. A life-giving force, the active presence of God in the human life, the third person of the Trinity. We should add that he is the active force in all creation. So underline that active force and the word all. And you're going to understand that as we go down further to get in a little more detail of his personage, talking about his personality. Genesis records in chapter 1 and 2, and chapter 1 verse 2, that the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters, indicating that the Holy Spirit was here even before Adam was created. He was. While the earth was in a state of confusion and chaos and covered with boiling, rolling, and billowing clouds of water vapor, the earth was actually void, the Bible said, darkness. He was there at the beginning. Why? Because it was the Spirit of God that ruled, that hovered over the universe. It was his power that just underlined where it said the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters, indicating the Holy Spirit was here before Adam was. So, no doubt the Holy Spirit is the working force or ages immediately behind the creative process. It's like the gas in the engine. I mean, you can't see the gas, but you see the results of the gas. All you know is that it must be some gas in that car because it's driving. I mean, I can't see the gas, but I see the power behind it, because when you, when the vehicle needs to move as it was designed to move, it does it. So there's some power behind, there's some influence behind it, because there is no other substance that can make a vehicle move except the gas. And I'm not talking about an electrical vehicle, I'm talking about a gas vehicle. There's only one substance that's gonna make it move. Put water in it if you want. It's not going anywhere. So it's like, I can't, you know, I'm gonna have to substitute today. I can't afford this gas out here. I'm gonna have to work up and get my own little stuff going on, because you know what? I just can't afford it, you know? I can't afford to be trying to get in God's face all the time. I ain't got time for that. I just gotta find me a... It's the nature of man to try to go around the working force that God has already assigned, sealed, delivered. I mean, it cannot be denied, cannot be misrepresented, cannot be ignored. You know, like the lady said on the movie, I won't be ignored. I mean, it's not that he has to speak up for himself. It's just the way it is.
That's right.
I mean, something is just, it is. It's just like breath, which he is. I mean, breath don't have to say, oh, you gonna need me. You gonna need breath. Don't have to argue back at you. Yeah, talk about me all you want. You gonna need breath. Ain't gotta say nothing.
Right. You gonna inhale it.
All breath gonna say, I know you gonna respect. You gonna respect me.
That's right.
Respect me or die.
Mm-hmm.
It's like being suicidal.
So that's the spirit of God fueling the body.
Right, and cause the body to function.
Right, that's like you went from the gas for the car. So what else could opposite that?
Nothing.
That caused the body to not function well. If you look at it as the spirit of enemy, or doubt, or fear, or not belief, unbelief,
right?
That it could.
When it comes down to your spiritual, spiritual relationship with God, to function properly, it has to have the mechanism to keep it running right, which is faith. Faith is the gas, it's the breath to keep it breathing. Keep the relationship going, because what he say, without faith it's impossible to please God. You're not gonna get anything from me. In other words, God say, I'm shut down on you. I don't know you. Okay? So that means you can't come with him to him in any other kind of way. And even as you said that, it reminds me of the manufactured breath that man has manufactured in a machine when they keep a person alive. You know what I'm saying? And so, yeah, oxygen. And so they use this just to keep the body. It's all superficial and not real. Because if they unplug it, and if that real breath is gone, it's out of here. That body is going out of here. I don't care what. If the breath is gone, and the power of the spirit is gone from it, it's gone. I know I'm kind of ahead of myself, but we're going to talk about breath somewhere down the line. So, for example, God the Father made the decision to create. God the Son gave the commands, which is the Word. Then God the Holy Spirit performed the actual work. Underline that. Then God the Holy Spirit performed the actual work. So when we allow the doctrine of the Holy Spirit to really saturate our very being, it'll cause us to be empowered to know that, you know, Lord, I need the power of the Holy Spirit to live. because we know we talked about the doctrine of Jesus Christ, which is the Word, but that alone is not enough. You gotta have the power behind the Word. Many people know the Word. The devil got 6,000 years knowledge of the Word, but no power. He just can't live it. So it does him no good. You know what I'm saying? You got people that don't even believe God, and they're fat in the Word. They'll know it. They'll quote it, but they can't live it. And they can't really understand it in a proper way where it'll benefit them. So we need the power of the Holy Spirit to perform the actual work of God in us. We need to know the doctrine, which is the principle, the law, the protocol. What is the practice? What is the rules? What is the procedures of the Holy Spirit? So I can really understand this thing the right way, and I won't misrepresent it and try to make him something that he's not, or try to make him fit into something. So in this way, we can understand God's phraseology when he said, let us make man. Let us make. His phraseology, the word, his explanation. We can understand what he meant when he said, let us. The us is the Holy Spirit, is the third person when he was talking about us. We talked about the doctrine of God, God the Father. We talked about God the Son, which it was Jesus Christ. What was his purpose? Why did he come? We even know that he was from the beginning, because he was what? Word. And then we can understand God in completeness with wrapping it up with the doctrine of the Holy Spirit. And so the Holy Spirit has personality. This is such a wonderful opportunity to really be able to think about the power of the Holy Spirit. Therefore, the personality of the Holy Spirit, of the Holy Ghost, is questioned for these reasons. Underline that heading, the Holy Spirit has personality. So, that personality of the Holy Spirit is questioned for because of these reasons. A, the Spirit seems impersonal. So when we think about, and you need to jot down the definition of these words as I explain them, because when we talk and when we're answering some of the questions, in the test, it'll be in regards to knowing exactly what is being conveyed here. So when somebody is impersonal, they kind of like what is the word we use? They're unfriendly, but we call them they're introverted. There's another word we call them. They're like we know that they're unfriendly. Introvert, but they're kind of like a loner. They're off to themselves. They're like
a loner.
So people see the Holy Spirit that way. It's like he's untouchable. Like he's you know how some people, they just like stand up like you can, unreachable. Mm-hmm. You're sort of like in their own shell. Mm-hmm. And people say that the Spirit seems unfriendly and just like, I just can't connect with God that way. Mm-hmm. And it's not really because they can't connect with God. It's their understanding, mm-hmm, is twisted. There are some misrepresent or some error there as to who the Spirit really is. So the visible creation makes the personality of God the Father easy to conceive. When you see the visible creation of God, it makes you to understand that there is really a God. There's a higher being there. God's dealing with the people of the Old Testament reflect the love, devotion, care, mercy, the judgments, and disappointment of God the Father. Underline go back up where it says, therefore, the personality of God of the Holy Ghost is questioned for three reasons. And A, underline the Spirit seems impersonal. So you need to know those three reasons. So the visible creation makes that the personality of God become real. In the old, God dealt with them in all these areas, devotion, care, like a father would. Chastisement, mercy. And so it is impossible to disbelieve in the personality of Jesus Christ. Mm-hmm. His entire exposure to mankind radiates his personality. How could such extraordinary personality be misrepresented? How could somebody misrepresent him? The Holy Spirit, Jesus Christ. Like in our last teaching, we talked about his birth is one of the biggest celebrations there is in our society, Christmas. And then his death is also, which is Easter. So how could somebody misrepresent somebody in their thinking? Somebody was born for you to save you from a life of condemnation. And somebody that resurrect for you to receive total bliss, a life of total, to be able to live with God in a total way of peace. However, the acts and working of the Holy Spirit are so secret, they're very mystical. So much is said of his influence, his grace, his powers, and his gift that we are prone to think of him as an influence, a power, or an agent, or rather than a person. So you can see the difference as to, okay, I can understand you not seeing the Holy Spirit as a person. I can understand you, but I don't understand how you misrepresent Christ, because he's seen as a person. But I can understand how you misrepresent seeing the Holy Spirit as a person, because he's viewed as an influence or a power. You understand what I'm saying here? So on this line where it says, how could such extraordinary personality be misrepresented? So we're talking about Christ, but however, underlying the acts and the working of the Holy Spirit are so secret and mystical, which means it's supernatural. So much is said of his influence, his grace, his power, his gifts, the gifts of the Spirit, you know. We are prone to think of him as an influence or a power or an agent rather than as a person. Yes. So this is the number, this is one of the reasons why the personality of the Holy Spirit is questioned, because he seems untouchable, unfriendly. How could you befriend somebody or something that seems to be untouchable? B, the Holy Spirit seems impersonal because of the names given him. That's number two, because of the names given him. That is the second reason. And I jot a note here, it just amazed me how at the same moment when I was studying this, we had guests in the home and they were asking Crystal, how do you know when the Holy Spirit is talking to you? And as Crystal walked off in her room, and her answer was that you just know, you just, what was your answer?
Through a still small voice.
Still small voice.
You mostly feel it in your heart. It's just, you just know.
You just know. So I just thought it was amazing how at the exact same time I was studying this, at the exact same time I heard her in the other room say, how do you know? I'm like, Lord, you just a master orchestrator of all things. It just amazed me how you just put things together in your personality, your power, your influences, just so if we can see that influence as a person rather than just a thing, I think we can better accept him and receive him and become a partner with him. You know what I'm saying? It's like a silent partner. Yet you know him as one that knows all, and that he becomes your guiding force in everything you do. In all your ways, acknowledge him, and he'll direct your path. Him, he's talking about the Spirit. So that's number two, is because the Holy Spirit seemed impersonal because of his names. So let's talk about those names that he's called. Breath. I mean, who can see somebody as a person with a name as Breath? Breath? Come here, Breath. Where's Breath?
You can't catch hold of Breath.
So we misrepresent him because of his name, Wind. Power. Underline that. He is called Breath, Wind, Power. There are symbols that also relate to the Holy Spirit. We talked about, we know in Scripture where it talks about the oil, fire, water. These are symbols. I mean, how could you see a person as being oil or water? So all three parts of God, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, they're all persons. John, the third chapter, let's talk about how the Bible see him as the Holy Spirit as person. John, the third chapter, the fifth verse. Fifth to the eighth verse. Jesus answered, verily I say unto thee, except a man be born of water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God. That which is born of flesh is flesh. That which is born of the Spirit is spirit. Marvel not that I say unto you, you must be born again. So the Holy Spirit is, he is what is called Spirit. Acts, the second chapter, see him as wind. So you got to be born of the Spirit, not just of the letter of the word of God, but also you got to be born of the Spirit first, and then I believe the letter of the word will come. Because we saw him as breath. So if you don't know him as breath, Holy Spirit, you are my breath. Every breath, you are a wind. I can't breathe. I can't live without you. You're the power that keeps me going. Acts, the second chapter, the first through the fourth verse. I need you to stop clicking. And when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. And suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled all the house where they were sitting. And there appeared unto them cloven tongues like as a fire, and it sat upon each of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost, and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. So suddenly wind came. John 20, see him as breath. John 20:22. And you have tons of other scriptures in your lesson where you can also go a little further. And when he had said this, he breathed on them and said unto them, receive ye the Holy Ghost. So this is Jesus talking. He said unto them, the verse before that, 21st, peace be unto you, as my Father has sent me, even so I send you. And when he had said this, he breathed on them. So when God the Son had sent them, he breathed on them and said, receive the Holy Ghost, receive the breath. So this gives reason for its erroneous belief of the Holy Spirit in personal influence emanating from the Father. Oneness people, which is the Unitarians, believe the Holy Spirit as only power without individuality or separate identity. Underline that. Oneness people, which is the Unitarians. Unitarians reject the doctrine of the Trinity. They see the Holy Spirit only as power, as a thing, as a substance, as an influence. Or it's just an influence. They don't see him as a third person of the Trinity. Number C. Another reason why people can't connect with the Holy Spirit is because of the word or name Spirit. That name, that word Spirit, is neuter, underline that, meaning a creature without sex. If something is neuter, meaning it is unable to reproduce, is neither masculine nor feminine. Romans 8, 16, let's go there. And it's probably gonna take us two lessons to get through this teaching on the Holy Spirit. Romans 8, 16. 16, the Spirit itself beareth witness with our spirit that we are the children of God. So it's neither, it has no gender when it comes down to a masculine or femininity. Go down to the 26th verse. Of Romans 8. Likewise, the Spirit also helpeth our infirmities. For we know not what we should pray for as we ought, but the Spirit itself maketh intercession for us with groaning which cannot be uttered. So this uses the neuter pronoun itself. A pronoun is another word that replaces a thing. A noun is a person, place, a thing. A pronoun is words like itself, or you, or they. It replaces the noun with words like itself, which is a pronoun. So when speaking of the Holy Spirit, the pronoun itself is used here in Romans 8. It is easily to understand then why in ignorance some do not believe the Holy Spirit as a person, or that he has personality. Let 10 be Bible proofs of the personality of the Holy Spirit. Bible proof that he has personality. Number A, names that imply personality are given to the Holy Spirit. He is called the Comforter. Let's go to John 14 and 16. 14 chapter 16 verse. And I will pray the Father, and he shall give you another Comforter, that he may abide with you forever. It did not say that it may abide with you forever. It said that he may abide with you forever. So, comforter means one who is called to your side, like a client calls a lawyer. He needs someone to comfort or to represent them or stand in their stay. This same word is used of Christ, thus cannot be used of any conceptual influence that a man himself came up with. So, underline where it says the Comforter, John 14, Comforter means one who is called to your side, as a lawyer, as a client calls a lawyer. B, personal pronoun of use of the Holy Ghost in John 16, 7 and 8 and 13 through 15. In these verses, the pronoun he is used of the Spirit. Underline that. In these verses, the pronoun he is used of the Holy, of the Spirit. And this is because the Greek word for Spirit is pneuma. And you know, Greek means the New Testament, and Hebrew means the Old. Pneuma is neuter, yet a masculine pronoun, ekinos, is used here. Ekinos means it's a masculine pronoun. Also in Romans 8, 16 to 26, the pronoun himself is used. See, the Holy Spirit is identified with the Father and the Son, as to indicate personality. Underline that. Underline also, if they had personality, so does the Holy Spirit. If the Father and the Son has... See, we can relate to the Father being personality. We can relate to the Son being personality. So if God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, the Holy Spirit is a person. See, one, the baptismal formula. Matthew 28:19. said, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Ghost. So if the first two names are personal, so is the third. Underline that again. C2. The apostolic benediction. The grace of our Lord Jesus, the communion of the Holy Spirit. Let's go to 2 Corinthians. I can't remember exactly. 2 Corinthians 13. 2 Corinthians 13, 14. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the Holy and the communion of the Holy Ghost be with you all. So you see the person of the three in the apostolic benediction. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. You see the love of God. You see the Father. You see the Son, the grace, the love of Jesus Christ. And then you see the Holy Spirit. You see all three of those persons right there. Be with you all. May all three of these persons be with you. C3, the identification with Christians. Acts the 15th chapter, the 28th verse. For it seemed good to the Holy Ghost and to us. Acts 10:38. How God anointed Jesus Christ of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost. He anointed him with the Holy Ghost and with power. He anointed him with the person. With his personal, with his personality and power. D, personal characteristics are ascribed to the Holy Spirit. He possesses his own will. Underline that. 1 Corinthians chapter 12. He possesses his own will. He used wisdom, prudence, and discretion in all distinguishing marks of personality. And I believe in 1 Corinthians 12 is where all the gifts are displayed. All these persons, these gifts, which is part of his personality. So in your personal time, it'd be good to read that, to really read that with now a different mindset. Mm-hmm. That I am reading in regards to the power of his personage, of his power. And these gifts are like part of the power, the influence, like the gift of tongues. The gift of tongues is not a person, but it's an influence. It's the byproduct of the person. You know what I'm saying? It's sort of like the characteristics. What flows from an individual, like a person, a child that resembles and have the DNA of the father. So they resemble the character, what comes off of them, what exudes from their being. The byproduct of, oh Lord, that child sure act like their father. Or they sure look how they act, look how they walk. That got that same lingo. They That same, it comes from them, exudes from them. So it's the same flavor when you read 1 Corinthians, the 12th chapter, his wisdom, his discretion, his distinguishing marks. The Spirit is said to have a mind. Romans 8:27 implies thought, purpose, and determination. Let's read that. Romans 8:27. And he that searcheth the heart, the Spirit. He that searcheth the heart knoweth what is the mind of the Spirit, because he maketh intercession for the saints according to the will of God. So he, which is the Holy Spirit, searcheth the heart, knoweth what is the mind of himself, of the Spirit. Even the Spirit that resides in a man, he knows. Because what? He make an intercession according to what God wants. So he has a mind, and he implies thought, purpose, and determination. E, personal acts are ascribed to the Holy Ghost. The Spirit speaks. Revelation 2:7. And so that shows forth his personality, that he is a person. He speaks. Matthew 17:5. Hear ye, the scripture says. Hear ye. So if we don't have the purpose or focus to hear, you won't hear ye hear. You won't pay attention to that he is talking. Because when you know, like a person misrepresent or don't have a relationship with somebody, and you try to talk to somebody you don't have a relationship with, and they sort of like ignore you. They don't hear you because you don't have a relationship with them, and they like, I was talking to you and you didn't hear me. I didn't know you was talking to me. So, I mean, it goes both ways. We treat God like that. But the Holy Spirit, I didn't know. Well, something said to me, and I just felt something talking to me, and I just, you know how they say, you need to follow your first mind. Mm-hmm. Because 10 times out of 10, most likely it is the Spirit that speaks. In a still, small, quiet voice, and you're like, God, I should have followed my first mind. And sometimes he speaks to us over and over again. And sometimes because we're not in the position we need to be, or we may be spiritually lethargic, we may be procrastinating, or we may be caught up in the other areas. And so we ignore him. So just think for a moment how you would feel if folk ignored you. Or your children ignore you. Just think of that. And how we act when they don't hear. And we're like, I told you, didn't I tell you? And they look at you like, I really don't know you. Like a 2-year-old look at you and they laugh, I'm not coming to you. Do I look like I'm coming? And they go the other way. I mean, just think how the Spirit must feel. Wow, just let that sit for a moment. And he just speaks and we like, And we do totally the opposite.
That's like, it really is relationship, because what I'm thinking is it's like being in a crowded room. There's so many voices, and that's really how we are today. It's so many things that's talking to us and calling us. So it's like being in a crowded room. Imagine if you was like at a party or something, a very crowded room with a lot going on and a lot of people. And all of these people began to call your name at the same time. And your husband was in that room. Out of all those people calling your name, you're going to recognize his voice and where exactly pinpoint where he is and what he's saying. You know, if it's chaos
and it's dark
and you don't know what to do. Yeah, and he called me, okay, just you hear me, you hear my voice, just follow my voice. Even through all that noise, it's like everything else gonna go quiet. And you gonna follow it, because you know, I go that way, he gonna lead me right, and he gonna lead me to live. And that's my lifeline. So everything else gonna kinda go quiet, even though it's loud. So it does, like you said, go back to relationship. Because when you have that relationship with him, you know, that's when the answer comes to you to that question, how you know when it is the voice of the Holy Spirit speaking to you. Because that relationship with him and what your husband saying to you connect with what he has said to you and what you know of him. When the Holy Spirit speaks to you and connect to what the God the Father and God the Son, the Word, have already spoken and revealed to you. So you already know. And you, everything else just kind of mute. And you hone in on that one voice, because you know, that's my lifeline. So it is relationship, like you said. Definitely.
It is. But imagine this. When we ignore him in that same scenario, and the room is crowded, and all kind of things are talking, and yet your husband is calling you, and you get in a frenzy and a panic. And so this is where we have to really tune in, because it's a whole different ball game when it comes down to the physical explanation.
Right.
Because we will naturally tune in. Okay, I know I hear my husband calling me. I know all these people. And I'm going to single right in on that. I got this.
Naturally.
Because naturally, we can't get this. But spiritually, it's a fight.
It's a challenge.
It's a challenge. It's a day to day thing that we got to wake up in the morning and choose to tune in on. And so this whole teaching is like a wake up call. I mean, it is. It's a refresher for me. It's one that I've learned years ago, but we do get watered down. And like I was, I believe we were saying in a support teaching, what are some barriers that can keep us? Lack, fear, sin,
doubt,
sickness. All these things can keep us from hearing him speaking.
Complaining and
to a murmuring. Very good one. Complaining. Because we are focusing on our issues so much so that we can't hear him. So we're kind of like in and out with it.
My thing is, I've been opening my eyes to that like a while ago, so I try to transfer that. When I know it's coming, I try to at least start praying at least something instead of like, shut up, I know who that is. I hear you, devil.
Exactly.
I know exactly what you're doing and what you're trying to do, and it ain't finna work today.
Exactly.
So shut up, and cut on some music or something, and just send my mind somewhere else instead of my issue that's really not so great.
Exactly, that's not so great. And so that's how the enemy comes. You know, this week has been a week I've been in bed all week with the flu. All week after such an awesome message on Sunday. And I know the devil has really thrown the kitchen sinks and the horse of hell after me.
Because you saw what you put on Facebook that about your body. I say, look at the devil trying to come at her.
Oh, I didn't remember
when,
that.
During the week, go back.
And that was when I was feeling better. Yet.
You wouldn't know. It was before you got sick.
That's what I'm saying. I was
like,
sick
at the enemy. The devil is a liar. I saw that. I was
like, oh, that's the truth now. You just devil. Woke me up and to
then,
that one.
And then the message, I was like, boy, devil, you just think you just... Man,
yes.
Just,
but it's all in the test. It's all in the test. Because the moment we stand up for God, the test, it goes to test. But you know what? People generally know that and they back off.
And they still,
From embarking upon being having the Holy Spirit as their silent partner because they know it's going to be an accountability. It's going to be a greater responsibility. They're going to be a greater requirement. You know, I know, you know, I can have him as my friend, but I don't know about going through this hard stuff. Mm. You know, I just need you to do this for me, God, and that's it. Don't be crying me to go through this other stuff. But it all goes together. All of it marinates and it goes together. And if you let it flow the way God wanted to flow, it'll come out to a beautiful cake. I don't care how much bitter
everything.
I don't care how much sarah seed you got in it. It's going to still come out taste good at the end. You know, it's some bitter and sweet together. But at the end, it's going to come out to a beautiful product. A beautiful life. You know what I'm saying? It takes all of that. So in my time, I had to, you know, I had to buckle down, you know, because when you got a headache that's constantly... I had a headache for 4 days straight.
That's horrible.
That pressure, that headache is constantly, and I'm constantly like this. I mean, I'm laying down all day like this, chilling my eyes, and I'm like, this headache, I got to get rid of this headache. Because when your head hurts, you can't function.
That's right.
So I had to call my mama to come. I gotta get this headache, got to go up out of here, devil. You got to go. So thank God, because of the prayers, I wasn't as bad as I could have been.
That's right.
Thank God. And you don't bounce back from the flu in 3 or 4 days.
That's right.
You're gonna ride that out for at least a month. Mm-hmm. You know? You're gonna ride it out, but I feel great. I feel my strength and my energy. But the devil is a liar. And I put that on there. The day I put the day, one morning I just rose up and I began to say the devil is a liar. And I believe that was Thursday. Then I had this atheist to start challenging me from one of my videos right after that.
Because you was up.
Right after that. If you go on our YouTube channel to one of our messages where the message didn't come through clear, he had a nerve to call the message fraud and the nerve of you to put this on here and the sound clarity of the sound is not even, and you're trying to get people money and the sound and clarity. Go back on when you get a chance, go back and you'll see our whole conversation from yesterday and how I went back and forth with him.
On Facebook?
No, on YouTube.
Oh, wow.
On our YouTube channel. And then I went in there and put another message. The devil is a liar. He's still a liar. And don't listen to him and his foolishness. And I begin to chuckle and I laugh. And I know he's mad because this person came and didn't even see my Facebook post. I don't think they did. But yet they chose to challenge me from one of my our videos that weren't as clear as it should have been. And I said it was my video and I chose to keep it.
Okay.
How about that?
And
I say we have almost a couple of hundred other videos that are very clear. So he wanna challenge me to come and be on his program with the way I teach about him. I'm like, no, I don't combat the word. It's not to be debatable before men. I'm not interested in that. I just teach the gospel, keep it moving. So we got to see him as a person that speaks. He speaks. The Spirit speaks. We got to hear him. We got to hear him because if we hear him, when we let our request be made known to him, guess what? He going to what? Make intercession for us. Wow. You see the power that we have in him The Spirit maketh intercession. Romans 8:26. As was said of Jesus also in Acts. In the other scriptures, he maketh the intercession for us. The Holy Spirit is seen calling missionaries, overseeing the church. So he is a person that's in charge of overseeing the power, the miracle, sign and wonder, all that it comes under the power of the Holy Spirit. So if we see him as a person and we partner with him and we agree to see him and respect him, we can see more of his power being manifested in our lives. So there needs to be an awakening there. F said the Holy Spirit is susceptible to personal treatment. Look at this. He is susceptible, just like you in your human personage. He is also susceptible, open. He is open to be, look at here, he may be grieved. Let's go to Ephesians 4:30. Ephesians 4:30. And grieve not the Holy Spirit of God, whereby ye are sealed unto the day of redemption. You see how dangerous this is. You're going to grieve the person that seals you until the day of redemption? And in my study sometimes when I'm preaching, I can feel God being grieved. Especially when the church, when we've heard the word over and over again. You think your son grieve you because he's hard-headed. Boy, you know you got a word. Boy, you know you need to do this. You know you need to be a man. You need to man up. Your daughter grieve you. Girl, stop letting them boys get your head. Do what you need to do. Grow up. Get your grades. Take care of your children. Or whatever the case may be. Come on. We can get this. We can get this. So if we are grieved when people disappoint us, just think how we disappoint God when we act retarded. You know, Lord, I see where you've given us the Holy Spirit to comfort us and to empower us and cause us to be all that we can be. To be filled with all your wisdom and knowledge, to walk in your gifts of the Spirit. To cause us to walk in truth and not error. You know, I can see that, but you know, that's just too much for me. He's just too impersonal for me. He just won't get what I'm telling him to get. He won't answer me like I want him to. He's just too unfriendly. I just can't talk to him. And so what we do? We grieve him and we figure, you know, forget that man. We quit. And we don't go after. We don't pursue him. Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call upon him while he is near. For the day will come when we'll want to seek him and can't find him.
That's right.
That's awesome. There was a Facebook post saying something about repentance. People don't want to hear the word repent, which means to turn away from what you are doing. Stop sinning. Repent don't mean, Lord, forgive me of my sins. That is not repenting. You're trying to ask God to forgive you. That's what you're trying to pardon. You're trying to excuse yourself. Repenting means stop it. Repenting ain't got nothing to do with your words at all. It has everything to do with your actions. So the post said, people in hell, you know, stop telling me to repent, but people in hell wish they could hear one more time.
That's the post I had. Yeah, I see.
Yeah, and before you send it, I've sent it out a few times. Mm-hmm. Yeah. People in hell wish they could, Lord, can I see that word one more time, repent? Because I get it now. But we grieve him because we don't turn from the way we're going. And grieving him could be merely our ignorance. We could grieve him. Our stupidity that does not have merit. We don't have reason to be stupid. Ignorant. I'm ignorant of some things I don't know. But when it comes down to knowing him and fellowshipping him and loving him and listening to him, we shouldn't be ignorant. The church shouldn't be. This should not be. We should know him in his person so we can experience the power of his person. Grieve not the Holy Spirit of God. So I hope from this we got a better understanding of what it means to grieve him. To grieve the Holy Spirit, and put this in your notes, means to stay the same. And I want to actually tell you some of the stuff that I'm saying out. You may want to jot it down, because sometimes I will put it on the test and you're not going to find it in your notes unless you wrote it down.
That's cheap.
So, what is the statement?
To grieve the Holy Spirit means not to stay the same.
To grieve the Holy Spirit means to stay the same. So if you want to offend him, stay the same. Don't change. Keep on with them same old sins you hiding and sneaking doing, and you think that he's not being bruised by it. Doesn't matter who don't see you. This must be the mindset of every child of God, every minister of the gospel. Because if we're not, we're going to give ourselves that excuse, ain't nobody perfect, and we're going to keep grieving with that same sin. We be right here like this. Ain't nobody perfect. Oh Lord, I'm smoking this. I'm bad. I'm going to take it one more time. Nobody ain't perfect. And you, this is about your thousandth time doing it. God is getting ready to slap some folk necks. Crooked.
Oh my
God. Totally crooked. As if he just dumb. You're just grieving him. I can really feel his heart. So it's time for the minister of the gospel and the child of God really to stop grieving God. Because it don't matter that the people don't see. What God sees is what matters. Next, he may be insulted. He may be insulted. Let's go to Hebrews 10:29. We're going to stop at
26 verse, and you read that.
Okay. We're going to stop on this page. I knew this teaching from the Holy Spirit going to be really, really going to take some time. Well, when we stop, we're going to stop on this page. And I know I'm going a little over, y'all.
Where you at?
107? We at 107. Go to Hebrews. Hebrews the 10th out of the 26th verse. Let's start at the 26. For if we sin willfully, my Lord, after that we have received the knowledge of the truth, there remaineth no more sacrifice for sin.
My God.
Hebrews 10:26. And also there's another scripture, I believe it's in Hebrews the 6th chapter 2. There's another one of these hard scriptures. that really, 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 really gets us to really, like, you know what? I got to stop playing with it. It's deliberately. And see, God does this is because the ability of man to choose. See, man, they can play with it all they want, play dumb. But God knows you are able to stop anytime you get ready. Any man, it's no such thing as somebody say they know Christ and they can't help it, they can't stop. They are lying. It's a bitter lie from the mindset of a man who just refused to stop. If he's not retarded, he understands what it means to eat when it's time to eat.
That's right.
Like I was talking about the 9-year-old that slapped that baby, and that was looking around at the nursing worker. When the nursing worker wasn't looking, he kicked the 2-year-old. This child need to be handled just like anybody else in their right mind. He don't need to get away with it. He needs to be punished. Because he has allowed some bad habits that he's picked up from somebody. He knows what's wrong. He know it was wrong. If he knew, if he didn't know it was wrong, he wouldn't have been looking at her. He would have said, this is what we do. Ma'am, I know you're sitting there watching. You watching me drop kick this 2-year-old, but this is the way it go, ma'am. It's right. So he knew it was wrong. That's why he snuck and did it. So he needs to be punished accordingly. So if we willfully sin, after we have received the knowledge of the truth, there remains no more sacrifice for sin. Meaning the blood of Jesus, the grace of God is not covering it. It's not helping it.
Jesus.
Imagine
somebody, the person keep coming to prayer for the same thing over and over. You thinking God is... Mm-hmm.
I think that depends because some people are genuinely caught up because they have not come, like the scriptures say, into the knowledge of. So some people, when they come over and over, they don't realize the power that they have in themselves because they're not saved yet.
Yeah. Right.
But it's not a lot of saved.
Hebrews 10:26. What she's saying, for somebody that has received the knowledge of the truth, no. Because the scripture firmly answers the question you just asked. And all I can put on that is period.
That's it. That is so plain.
And that there's no reason. It's telling you that they're habitually. I think I did a teaching on that. There's a difference to premeditated. You thought about that, then all of a sudden it just happened. The law sees it that way. That's the way the law and wisdom is judging it that way. Some things happen as a result of the atmosphere, or the person, fear came, or all of a sudden in a moment of fright, they just did something. That's totally different than, okay. I'm gonna do this. Yeah, I like that. Some people say, I ain't gonna do that no more. But soon, when the opportunity comes for them to prove that they don't, for their mouth to come up with their will, because it's your will to say they're going to do it no more. Talk is cheap. Because God going to give you an opportunity to walk that out, to be able to master that, like he told Cain. Sin lie right now, but I need you to master it. Meaning, I'm not playing with you anymore. I've been watching you. You say or you act according to your own choosing. So you've been choosing to submit yourself over and over again to this. This is not a thing whereas you got the case of it can't happen. This is a case of this is what I want to do.
That's it. Point blank.
Basically.
Point blank.
So since you've been wanting to do this, how about I need you to want to master it? So either you keep doing what you want to do, or get on my side, Cain, and agree with me and master it. Why? Because you can. So you act like you can't stop lusting, or you can't stop drinking. You're doing it because you want to. Okay? Young man knocked on my door drunk as a skunk last night. And he looked at me and he said, you can't stop me from coming. You can't stop me from coming over here. And I looked at him and said, I gotta go, I'm cooking. I closed my door. And in my spirit, I'm saying, devil, I don't have time for you. You can come over here all you want, but I'm not dealing with you.
I ain't coming over there.
I don't have a problem with drinking. So whoever you coming after, they need to deal with you, not me. This is not my fight. So I ain't going up in it. Could you please?
Oh, no.
I don't want to be rude. I'm closing my door. I'm cooking.
Right out of my way.
When I got a revelation off that, when I was at the door, I know what the person said when he came up to you. But when you told me that when I came in the house, he said he gonna start coming. But I think sometimes I go out the door, the boys be out the door like they have a party.
And who need to handle that territory outside of their environment? Who needs to handle that?
I tell them, don't y'all come here doing it. Y'all need to go to the park somewhere. I know when they be at the drink, or they go in the garbage can, they got liquor bottles in the garbage can, cups all in the yard. So, and I tell them.
If there's an issue, and if you are mixing and mingling in that environment, you're not going to get anywhere. But if you put your foot down in any environment, when it comes down to the devil and the Holy Spirit reigning in you, oh, you gonna get results, and they're gonna respect you. Oh no, not over there. I don't have that problem inside my house. If I want to go outside and deal with the situation in the neighborhood or whoever that is hanging around, I can do that. But God, I ain't got the energy for that. I ain't, you know what? You're not gonna work me out. You know what I'm saying?
Bye.
Because if God calls somebody else to clean up right here, that's what they need to do. Okay? Because I might go out there with my stick along with the spirit.
Go out there with your will.
But I'm going out there with a will and the spirit. I'm going to be like Jesus up in here.
Oh.
So I'm going to do a double dose right here. I'm going to be whipping it and rebuking at the same time. So the devil comes, but it behooves every man to make their decision to remain in Christ. That 27th verse says, but a certain fearful looking for of judgment and fiery indignation, which shall devour the adversaries. He that despises Moses' law died without mercy under two or three witnesses.
Without mercy.
Of how much sore punishment suppose ye?
Jesus.
Shall he be thought worthy who have trodden underfoot the Son of God? I'm going to read that again. Shall he be thought worthy who have trodden underfoot the Son of God? Meaning all the whips and all that Christ went through for you to be free of sin and to walk as a son of God. You just take that and like it ain't nothing. I can't stop it. And I'm going to show you I can't stop it. And shall you be counted worthy? And you trodden and you live a slumish life? And your influence in the earth was nothing to those that are around you. Shall you be thought worthy? You trot that on the foot and have counted the blood of the covenant, meaning the blood of Jesus wasn't even enough to sanctify you. Where he was sanctified an unholy thing and have done despite unto the spirit of grace. The question is, for we know him that have said, vengeance belong unto me, and I will recompense, said the Lord. And again, the Lord shall judge his people.
Hmm.
So, excuse my French. These verses is basically showing you how pissed off he is. You know, when somebody pissed off and they mad, I've been insulted. So I'm going to let you know that I've been insulted. I mean, it's just, you see how we can be in a need of really a true repentance, a true sanctifying. So he's acceptable to personal treatment. You can insult him, and many of us do today. He may be lied to. Well, you know the story.
Yep.
They dead today, and their story rings so loud that folk don't even want to go to Acts 5. Ananias and Sapphira, they lied to the Holy Ghost. I mean, they sold the property. It belonged to them. But they had done promised the man of God what they were going to do with it. Apostle, if we get this money, we're going to break off a piece for the church. And we're going to help the ministry.
All that talk.
And we're going to help. We're going to help the work of the Lord. You know, we doing this for the work of the Lord. But honey, when they got that money, that money had done changed their mind. And they agreed as a couple to lie to the Holy Ghost. My Lord, I feel that thing deep down in my belly. You see how serious that is? So it's time out for a man's pansy gospel. It's time for ministers, true ministers of the gospel, to come forward and stand up on the rooftop and cry loud and spare not and open your mouth like a trumpet.
And you know who looking back at what you said?
Mm-hmm.
The sinner man.
Mm-hmm. Yep,
said,
exactly.
I thought they said this would be so and so and so and so.
They show.
The sinner man looked back at him. And then he pointed the finger. That's another excuse for him not to come.
That's
it. So you see.
Well, there it is.
That's
our influence again.
We understand why you didn't do it, though. You ain't they trying to explain that. And try to tell nobody then, so they don't know. They know you said.
You said.
That's just what it's going to be. You can do it. All you have to do is say, no, we can't do that. We
got to
go another route.
Explain. Be clear to people.
That's right. That would hold them back to keep them.
See, that's relationship.
Keep them from doing what they're supposed to do or coming to Christ or whatever.
Exactly. That's what all relationship entails.
Shut up and don't say nothing.
Exactly. Unless you are really being unctioned by God, you be quiet. Exactly. Because it's a dangerous place to be in.
You want people to come and believe you, and you tell them this so you can make them think you're going to do it, and you might not be able to do it. So it's best to shut up. You know you can do it.
Exactly. And do you know people lie to people just that way? They lie to people just that. You got leaders that lie to people just that way. And I'm talking about leaders that got hundreds of members. And they do it over and over again. And the people ignore it because they figure that's real. That's the bishop. That's the apostle. That's the pastor. That's the prophet. So we can't, you know. He may be blasphemed and sinned against, which is the impardonable sin. When you blaspheme means to speak against the Holy Spirit. We're going to end it right there. He can be blasphemed when you speak against, and I know we scratched you a little bit today. In your study time, you could go to Matthew 12:30, 12:31, and 32. You can where it talks about blaspheming. Wherefore I say unto you, all manner of sin and blasphemy shall be forgiven unto men, but the blaspheme against the Holy Ghost shall not be forgiven unto men. And whosoever speaketh a word against the Son of Man shall be forgiven him. But whosoever speaketh against the Holy Ghost, it shall not be forgiven him, neither in this world, neither in the world to come. My Lord. Either make the tree good and its fruit good, or else make the tree corrupt and its fruit corrupt, for the tree is known by the fruit. So we speak against the Holy, the Son of God, Jesus, okay, he'll forgive you for that. But when you speak against it's because of the power of God. You speak against the power. That's why I tell people, when you don't understand stuff, just be quiet. Everything, we not gonna quite get it. We not gonna quite understand. I saw a show on the man talking about, he was displaying some paganism in the body and in the church at large today. And what, on his show called Ratchet, he was showing some YouTube videos of some people doing some spiritual things, whereas he couldn't find it in the scripture. Some different things people were doing, like Smith Wigglesworth, one of the old patriarchs that died with the power of the Holy Ghost and speaking in tongues and all these, you know, Martin Luther, the old patriarch, like Charles Finney, and all these old patriarchs that we studied about the one time. And these people was at the grave of Smith Wigglesworth, and they were saying that the power that he walked under wasn't dead, because of the spirit is never, does not die, which is true. And that same oil that he carried is still alive in the earth today. And they was at his grave, and on the YouTube video, they was just releasing that spirit over to anybody that want to receive that power and walk in miracles inside and wonder. Well, he was doing that. He was showing the video and saying, well, you don't need to go before, and it was right. You don't need to have somebody to release that over you like that over the, from the YouTube video or whatever the case may be. You know, you can go to the spirit. You can go to the spirit. You can go to God for yourself. It is true. You need to be in a relationship with God. You need to build a relationship instead of trying to go around doing things in a personal way. And he was just going from that, and another thing he was showing, how the lady said she died and went to heaven, and the Lord, she wrote a book. And well, he was saying how you got hundreds of people that died and went to heaven, and the Lord had them to come back and write a book about heaven and salvation or whatever. But you cannot put that in stone, that everybody that said that God is not dealing with them.
The man went to hell.
And you can't. Yeah, he talked about David and Lazarus, and how Lazarus was rose, and how the man told him. But he used the scripture where God say, you know, where the rich man told him to tell them to tell them not to come here. That sent Lazarus to go and tell them. And he was, how the Bible said, well, if they not going to listen to Lazarus, why would they listen to a man that's alive? People that are alive, you know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. So it does make sense what he was saying, but you can't just say what the spirit is not free to do outside of revealing the name. So I wouldn't play with that.
Right.
I wouldn't be an advocate that way. It's kind of like, you know, it's kind of fine. It's a fine. He was not like walking a fine line. He could be right in some areas, but I'm like, ooh, I'm kind of like scared for him. Because, you know, he has some points and some things. People do get cuckoo. They get yo-yo. They get kind of schizo. They come up with all kinds of cuckoo, cricket, crazy things. But in some ways, you can't. Because he said, well, it's not in the Bible. Well, everything, he said, well, this lady, these people might have started, they need to start from Revelation, the 22nd chapter, and do their book in Revelation. Okay, that is a point. Yes, because the Bible is still, God is still writing. The Bible, the 66 books we have, is not enough to hold what the work of the Spirit has done.
That's right.
Big enough.
Even what Christ did in his ministry, short time, he says not enough space in the whole universe to hold a book that was written.
It can't even
does what Christ himself.
Exactly. Did. So it's kind of like a thing.
Imagine the Spirit.
Exactly. Imagine the Spirit and all that the Spirit does that we don't even. The higher height, but God say far as the sky is from the ground. My ways, the heavens from the earth, my thoughts and my ways are just so vastly different.
Right.
So our minds can't even, you know so you can blaspheme against the Spirit, and you can't even get close to playing with that. So I'm like, ooh.
In the natural, you can see where man has come from in the medical field. There was a time, maybe 10 years ago, they would have did that surgery like they did on Walter. And it could have paralyzed him.
Right.
And they wouldn't do it. So that just shows you how God has made the medical, the physical. Mm-hmm. What about the spiritual?
Right.
And if he has made so much progress mm-hmm. in the physical.
Absolutely.
Just a medical field. Hey, he's the same God yesterday and he's same God today.
Imagine that.
And how much more can he do in the spiritual realm?
You could cut us off then. Imagine that. Imagine.